welcome to the Week 9 edition of the Coach's Corner on Leominster TV. Alongside Leominster High School head coach Devin Gates, I am Todd Robbins. Happy to have you along with us for the Coach's Corner for Week 9 of high school football season. And of course, that begins with the first question that some of you may be asking yourselves, have you not seen some of the publications? And that is, who's Leominster playing in Week 9? The powers that be have selected Westboro as Leominster's Week 9 opponent, and that game will be contested on Friday night, November the 8th at 7 o'clock at Doyle Field. We'll have more on that as we continue through our broadcast. But first, Coach, we flash back to Week 8 action and then your matchup against Algonquin. And this was a game where you knew you had a really good week of practice going in. Friday night came along, the team with senior night and everything else seemed maybe a little discombobulated going into the start of the football game. And then you guys seemed to get some traction at some points early in the football game.
Sure. I mean, I think any time that you have, you know, you do something that's a little out of the ordinary that kind of breaks, you know, the cycle of what they're used to, sometimes it can kind of throw a monkey wrench into how you start, kind of the flow and the feel of it. So, you know, we weren't as dialed in as I would have liked to start the game, and I think you could see that in some of the production that we had, especially offensively. But once we had halftime, made some adjustments, kind of, you know, roused up the broke off the cobwebs. We had a lot better for second half
once we were able to shake things free. But there was one play early on in the football game that, although maybe offensively it didn't go well, it eventually led to some serious points, and that came in a way of a big fourth down play from Liam Curtin on a botched snap on a punt. We've got the video. Let's talk through that first, and then we'll go from there. Hostage does the punting, stands at his own 15 for the Tomahawks to await the snap as we go under center.
So we got a nice high snap there. Liam does a good job rushing in. He's always with a good angle to make the block, and he happened to be there with the ball there, and made a big play for us.
Got loose over the middle of the play. The play took long. We'll get one more look at it on replay from LTV, and you know, it was one of those cases, Coach, where maybe initially it looked like perhaps there was some contact or what have you, but truly he just saw there was a ball on the ground and just got on top of it.
Yeah, I mean, he's been starving to make a play. He's he's a great kid. He's worked really hard. He's been frustrated with, you know, with his own contributions to the team. He's not for lack of trying, but I think to be able to come through and make that happen for us and have it result in points was really, really great for Liam.
And that was the play from Liam Curtin. And of course, it was a big kind of spark point, Coach. Gave you the football close to where you wanted to ultimately end up, yep, which was to take the ball to pay dirt. Justice Reynolds comes in, and a few plays later, you matriculate your way in and end up with an early 7-0 lead.
Yeah, no, it's just fortunate for us. We haven't had too many of those bounces this year go in our favor. So to be able to capitalize on it, you know, was key. And I think it really, you know, after that was really, you know, a good wake-up call for us too. We're in this game. We're taking the lead. We're going to take charge, and we're gonna go and take it. So, you know, great play by LT, a great heads-up play. You know, good special teams for us. I thought special teams in the game as a whole was great for us. And then to be able to turn it into points fairly quickly was huge for us.
The total numbers don't bear out how tough that first half really was, because they do rebound quite a bit, but you can see in most statistical categories you guys did trail even all the way through the end of the football game, right through time of possession. But there's a key number there where you didn't trail, and that was turnovers. You forced two, created two, turned them into points, and that made the real difference in the football game, gave your offense the chance it needed, even if it wasn't going to possess and rack up a bunch of yards and everything else.
Yeah, they coughed it up going in, you know, which could have been a score for them, and you know, they had a fortunate fumble for us, and we were able to take care of it and move the ball and flip the field a little bit, and then obviously the interception at the end there to seal it from LT Curtin was great for us as well.
Yeah, you know, you mentioned, you know, Liam, you know, kind of being in a place this season where he was just waiting for that chance.
Yes, absolutely.
He had different roles that he was filling throughout the team. He was waiting for that chance to make a play. Seemed like the opportunity came along for him on that fourth down play, and then it seemed like throughout the night from that play on, we were calling his name quite a bit on defense. He kept showing up throughout the night, and then, as you said, gets the interception to seal the game.
Yeah, I mean, defensively, you were able to really notice him a lot. He was in the right spot, was making a lot of the right calls. He's there kind of directing the defensive backs and making sure we're in position. He did a great job of that, you know, and really, you know, limited some of the big plays that they've gotten so far this year. And then on offense, he's always always just solid. He is where he's supposed to be. He's a good leader there, and I think this was by far Liam's best game, both sides of the ball and special teams.
When you went back and looked at the video on the offensive side of things, obviously we noted where the offense ended with 140 total yards. That first half of action, 18 total yards, one first down really to speak of in total in that first half. You still maintained an early 7-0 lead. When you looked back at the video and kind of thought things through, aside from obviously starting a little flat,
yeah,
what were they doing that was causing so much grief for your offense being able to move the ball down the field?
Well, they were doing a good job against our pullers in our run game and being able to shoot the gaps with their linebackers and get some penetration upfield and kind of blowing up our pulls a little bit. So it was forcing us to bounce things a little bit wider than we wanted to or try to cut back where there wasn't any cutback lane. So that was really tough as far as the running game goes. In the passing game, they were really good at reading the passing keys and linebackers dropping into holes where, with a quarterback in Caden who hasn't had too many starts under his belt, who's obviously making strides. But when you put what seems to be like 8 guys out there in pass coverage, it's tough. It's tough to see. I think our protection, we did a great job. But they made it hard for us to see some passing windows. And, Caden as an athlete was able to turn some of those circumstances into some first downs with his legs. So that helped out. But they had a good game plan against us, and we were able to kind of scratch and claw, get the yards that we needed, and turn it into points.
Let's take it aside for a moment from a perspective of a quarterback. For those of us that have never played nor will ever play the quarterback position, when you drop back to pass and you're looking downfield, you have this kind of vision for somebody, I think, who's only played video games. Yeah. That you're looking for these little windows, and it's magically the receiver and the defender are going to be there, and you just hit the A button, and the ball goes there. I mean, it's amazing. I mean, it's really simple, in a Madden video game. When you actually have to drop back and read all those things, like you said, you're looking at anywhere between 7 and 11 players downfield in a mess, plus all of your guys going down and trying to create routes. What are you able to really see when you drop back, set, hit that back foot? What are you really able to see out there from a quarterback position?
Well, it's tough. I mean, obviously, your perspective is kind of skewed, not the video game perspective, because that's beautiful.
It's a great view if you had it.
A lot of space, always space. But when linebackers start to really drop and get into their holes, it makes, like a 10-yard hole that you think you'd have to throw the ball into, it makes it look like a 2-yard hole. So it's really tough to judge how much space you have and what kind of ball you want to throw. And Caden not wanting to put the ball in danger, would hold on to it until he needed to get out of the pocket. So I think some of those things, guys he was keying in on, guys we talked about where the routes would be open, Algonquin did a great job of getting guys in those windows. So we got to do a better job of trying to clear those windows up for Caden and adding some play action, adding some stuff that's going to get those linebackers away from the pass windows to kind of clear it up for them a little bit. Because it does. It can look like there's 1,000 guys out there, some guys in a pass window. We have our protection, and we tell our guys the quick passes, we call them, they got to be out 1.7 seconds. And then any of the longer passes, you don't have any more than 3 seconds. So we're trying to analyze all that stuff and see it in that time frame, which isn't an easy thing to do for a seasoned veteran at quarterback, let alone a kid who's just started playing the position over the last month. But being that as it may, he has made a lot of progress, and looking forward to see. This definitely was a learning situation for him, and we went back and watched the film, and so we can kind of see what they did to us, we can understand a little bit better. So now, hopefully moving on to this week, we can move on from that and just get better.
So if you put that into context, then your window, you're saying, is anywhere between a second and a half and 3 seconds, which means for a quarterback who started the season as a wide receiver who really hasn't naturally played this position before, he's got fractions of a second to make the decision that's the hole I need. And, by the way, it's not like everybody's standing still. You've got to thread the needle with people in motion in fractions of a second.
Yeah. I mean, he's up for the challenge. He's a competitive guy, and he wants to do well and wants to do right by his teammates by making the right play, right call. So he's really learning and putting this all together. And I think it will really take a good off season to really fully understand what the job is. So we as coaches, even myself, being the play caller, got to put him in a spot where he doesn't have all that stuff he's going to look at a little bit. Maybe make it a little bit easier for him in terms of, side of the field, receivers, moving the pocket a little bit. So may have to help him out a little bit with play calling and put him in a position to succeed a little more.
Is this like in practice where the coaches reel out like the big dummies and like make them like 7 feet tall and try to fill up the lanes fill up some space somewhere along the way?
Yep.
Somebody back there that has been helping Caden Constant from an offensive standpoint has certainly been Justice Reynolds. We've kind of chronicled over the last so many weeks takes his development. We were waiting for that breakout game. We knew he had that breakout potential. He's had it multiple weeks in a row here, and is showing obviously that he can carry the load.
Yeah.
And I was thinking back about, you know, some of the situations when I look at athletes. Athletes either cave under pressure or they crave pressure. Mm-hmm. And it seems like Justice Reynolds waited until all the pressure showed up and he took a look and went, well, I might be the only healthy running back we have. I think I want this responsibility. Yeah. And he seems to have seized on it.
Yeah, no, I mean, you know, what he's done, you know, Brian Cordero's done a good job too, but really Justice over the last 2 weeks has provided a lot of stability and a lot of rhythm to our offense, and that you can see that in the overall, you know, production being more than what we've had, you know, so far, and being able to convert on some you know, some longer plays or longer down and distance, and then being able to be more balanced offensively too, being able to open up the pass game a little bit for Caden, you know, and that's what Justice has provided. You know, Justice is a soft-spoken kid. He doesn't say a heck of a lot. But, you know, we had talked to him a couple weeks ago and say, hey, don't worry about trying to get to the outside. He was having some problems trying to get outside. Mm-hmm. But he told him, just, hey, run hard, run downhill. And now that has turned into, you know, what you've seen in the last 2 weeks, which is, you know, something that we were pretty excited about. You know, looking forward to what he can do this week, too.
On the other side of the football, your defense continues to do really well from a scheme standpoint. They recognize what the other team wants to do, and they pretty much decide, yep, they're not going to do that. They may beat us some other way, but they're not going to do that.
Yeah. No, Coach Murphy, again, a great job with the game plan. You know, it's with a kid like Rio Ferguson, 44 for Algonquins. You know, I think he was a lot faster than we thought he was. So he has that bruising running style, and he gets his shoulders squared downhill. But he got around the corner. Thankfully, a play that was called back for a block in the back. But, you know, when he turned that corner, I thought we were going to have the angle on him to stop him, but we didn't. But, you know, credit to Coach Murph. We made the corrections after that, and he didn't have any other big, you know, big outside runs, you know, perimeter runs. Just was chipping away on the inside. He's a tough football player. But we knew we were going to have to stop him to have a chance. And we were able to do that, make some plays when we needed them. You know, Kyle Philbin had a great game, a couple sacks, you know, at the best possible moments, and really came through for us.
Sometimes it seems like, whether it's Kyle Philbin or some of the other guys up front, Micah Stinson at points in time, their explosiveness from snap to the person that they want to get to is seemingly in that tenths of seconds frame that we were talking about a little while ago. So instead of kind of closing that quarterback's window, dropping back downfield, sometimes you can close the window by just getting there real, real fast.
Yeah, I mean, if the rush has gotten you that fast, you don't have time to look downfield. Usually it's just kind of, you have to move and try to break the pocket and make something happen outside of it. And, you know, we've done a good job, I think, of dialing up the right kind of pressures and being able to play sound enough coverage there where we're not giving them a heck of a lot of windows to throw the football into. A lot of the stuff has been contested, you know, as far as the when quarterbacks have been breaking the pocket and getting downfield with the ball. You know, we're doing a good job of closing the space. And, you know, I can't say enough about our front, Joe Conlon, Micah Stinson, Caleb Nacioni has been in there too, Kyle Philbin, obviously, and then the backers too, with Anthony Tosi and Jack Philbin providing pressure. Coach Murph's done a great job of mixing it up with those guys and keeping it fresh and really kind of keeping, you know, opposing offenses off balance too. So
had a handful of contributions from your secondary as well. They might have been the spot on the defense early on in the season where people look to exploit going downfield, throwing over the top of them. Not only do they seem like they're doing a really good job of limiting and staying with their contributions as far as protecting downfield, but at points last week, they were stepping up in places, whether it was Liam Curtin or Lee Gallott, and they were an added piece or pressure or another than a little scheme device where they stepped up into the role and started to add pressure through the middle or off the edges to push the plays, whether it was run or pass.
Yeah, I think they're understanding how they fit into the whole scheme a little bit better now. It's not coverage and front, it's defense. It's a whole scheme and where they fit and how they play and what we're trying to force the offense to do, and, you know, and being at the right place at the right time. I think they're understanding that a lot more. You know, we've been able to play with some of the same guys out there now for a couple weeks in a row, so that consistency has been able to help a lot too. It was tougher early in the year. We've had some guys that were in and out due to injury. Being able to strike that balance, that chemistry of those guys playing back there. The secondary is, you know, it's like a, you know, synchronized swimming act. You know, you got to make sure the guys kind of flow in the right way, and if one guy's off, then, you know, you can up some big plays. And to now to have some consistency in that department has been, you know, has really paid dividends for us.
Every football coach I've ever sat with talks about offense, defense, special teams. Coach Dubczynski those early years when I was in high school, and I'd ask him for keys to the game. When you go back and look at it, every one of them was an offense, defense, and special teams. Your special teams, we looked at early in the season, we're like, ooh, this needs to grow. Yep. And now all of a sudden, it has started to sprout and grow and take root. Santi Rodriguez is kicking the ball better than perhaps he has all year long over the last couple of weeks, particularly this week, really putting a solid foot into it. And of course, that just speaks to steadfast perseverance, staying with it, and not giving up when things got difficult early on in the year.
Yeah, I mean, Santi's got all the credit. Coach Benz has been working with Santi Rodriguez after practice as well, too, putting in some extra hours with the kicking game. And, he doesn't really get a lot of that during the natural part of practice. But being able to help him, develop his foot, develop, his punting style and being a lot more consistent there in his approach and in his motion, it's certainly helped. He's really starting to punt the ball a lot better. We'd like to see him we want to make sure that it stays consistent. But he really is able to, on the kickoffs, kind of put it where we want him to put it. And that really is a huge weapon for us in terms of, getting it away from threats like Iman Dennis a couple weeks ago against St. John's, or taking advantage of where we think weak spots in the return is. So to be able to do that and have him understand it is really been beneficial to us the last couple weeks.
Run into only one woe, and this is, again, speaks to somebody who is just new to the position, standing on the back line, hasn't punted out of his own end zone yet in his career as a football player, stands along the back line of the end zone, gets pushed back a little bit by the snap, and catches the back line for a safety.
Yeah. But when I go back and look at it, if he doesn't do that, I'm not sure the game goes the way it went.
I was going to ask you, because sometimes, coaches plan on taking that safety.
I'm not trying to say this is the way it wants to happen, but it crossed my mind for a split second. But being able to do that, obviously we gave the 2 points, but we were able to flip the field position after that. To hold them and then get the ball back where we got it, that allowed us to go down and put points on the board. If we say we have an inconsistent punt from Santi there and they get the ball back on the 20, and then we're in a different situation. So the 2 points thankfully didn't end up hurting us. You could argue that they really helped us get to where we wanted to go. So come some slack on that one. We'll work on it this week in the special teams and making sure we know where we're at. And only if the coach from now on says we'll take a safety, we're going to have our foot on the line.
So. Not all giving up of points is necessarily a bad thing.
No. It got us to where we wanted to go.
And that is the key to Leominster right now. They got where they wanted to go. 14-10, a victory over Algonquin, picking up their second win on the season. And coach, this one seemed to come at a really important time. It felt like there was a chance where the season could have slipped away at some moment in time, where you would have maybe gone through these crossover games, got swept up, been on a real negative note going into Thanksgiving after a bye, and just you could have lost the season there after only winning week one.
Yeah.
So picking up a win in week eight seems like it really reinvigorates the team going into these next couple of weeks, and then obviously aiming for Thanksgiving.
Yeah, and the kids have done a really great job of not letting the losses get them down too much. I mean, obviously the frustration is there, and the kids know we have a better team than our record has shown. And the seniors provide that leadership and making sure the guys stay focused on the task at hand each week. So it's with the losses that we've had, we put it to bed. On Monday when we get back to work, and we don't look back on it. We don't look back on it and talk about what coulda, shoulda, woulda. We don't do that. We're moving on to the next thing. And it's a credit to our guys. We've had some heartbreaking losses, some really tough situations, and a lot of things, a lot of adversity to battle through. But the smiles are still there. They're still coming to work. They're still working incredibly hard. And I think they're working harder now than they were, a couple weeks ago or even at the beginning of the season. I think that shared adversity has brought everybody together. So no matter what happens, these guys are really playing for each other, and it's really nice to see.
2-6 through the first 8 weeks. Leominster with Westboro coming up in week 9. Let's wrap up week 8, taking a look at some of the other scores that went on around the region in week 8 and kind of how that affected the overall picture of what we're going to look at. St. John's picks up a big win over Wachusett. Wachusett was the top seed going into week 8. They will finish week 8 also as the top seed. We'll see in a minute. but they dropped their last regular season game to St. John's 14-7 in what could be a preview of the Central Mass Final in 2 weeks' time. Shrewsbury tops Neshoba 24-13. Shepherd Hill hangs 50 on the second seed, Doherty, to their 40. We'll see what that plays out and how that plays out. Obviously, Shepherd Hill is going to be in the playoffs, as will Doherty. Tantasco picks up a 21-14 win over Grafton. North Middlesex over Marlboro 20-14, and in what was clearly the game of the week, an overtime comeback victory for Fitchburg. They win 29-27 over a Westboro team that was looking and hungry for a victory there, and they drop a heartbreaker to Fitchburg in overtime, 29-27. Power rankings through the 8 weeks of action, you can see it. The numbers didn't change dramatically. The top four teams stayed exactly where they were, minus a few percentage points. The only flip that happened was Algonquin and Shrewsbury traded places with the results from week 8. Shrewsbury finished in the fifth slot, 4-4 overall record, 14.5 power ratings points. Algonquin finishes 3-5 at 11.8 power ratings points. But either way, Shrewsbury, Algonquin, and Leominster all out of the playoffs through this number of weeks. And coach, before I continue on and take a look at some of these brackets, this has been a hot topic across the state over the last couple of weeks. Eastern Mass is going berserk. They have the 7-week regular season with 8 teams into the playoffs in their divisions. And they ran off Mike Lynch of WCVB, now emeritus to WCVB Sportscasting, ran off their Twitter list and just literally the scores. Didn't include the teams, didn't include the matchups. These were the scores in Eastern Mass. They were all double-digit large victories with single digits to opposition. Something about this playoff format is going to have to change, and maybe it's going to need to be more of a statewide solution than a fiefdom solution where each part of the state plays separately.
Yeah, I mean, you're looking for parity there and be able to get the best teams out there, and I get the other side of the coin is where you want these other teams to be involved and give them a chance. You know, some teams have certain circumstances where they go like ourselves, they're starting to peak now towards the end of the season, and you know, maybe if we got in the playoffs, if they included everybody in the division, we'd have a chance to move on. But you know, I get that side of it, but the other side of it, you got to earn it. And the teams that go out there schedule the tough games and play a tough schedule and go out there and succeed, then they deserve to play the other teams across the state in the same divisions that are doing the same thing.
And creativity is the name of the game. So here are the brackets for Division 3 and 4, which touch Central Mass here. You can see, as we saw on those power ratings information, Wachusett finishes with the top seed. They'll get 4-seed Shepherd Hill in what will be a battle of ground games there. That'll be Friday night, November the 8th. That'll be at Hallane Field on the campus of Wachusett Regional. And then St. John's finishes in the 3-hole. They will travel to Doherty. The game will be played at Foley Stadium in Worcester, a place where Doherty spends a lot of their season. That game will be an opening round playoff game, and again, surprises could abound there, where perhaps you end up with a 1-3 in that Central Mass final, where you get a rematch of that Wachusett-Doherty game, but you know, could end up with any of those four teams finding their way into the Central Mass final. Four kicks, let's take a look at Division 4, and you can see Fitchburg tops Division 4 with a fantastic season, a 6-2 record through the first 8 weeks. They will draw their rematch with Neshoba. That was a game that was won by Fitchburg on a field goal during the regular season. They will rematch against each other coming up on Friday night, 7:00 at Crocker Field. We'll have more on that info coming up in a little doubleheader split squad coverage we're going to have for you on the K-Zone in a moment. Tantasco and Groton-Dunstable finishes the 2-3 seed in that division. And of course, this one seems fairly wide open. We'll see who finds their way into the D4 Central Mass Final in the coming weeks as well. For Leominster, we mentioned they drew Westboro in their game for Friday night, 7:00 kickoff against Westboro at Doyle Field. Week 10 still to be determined. That information will come up this coming Sunday. Coach, we'll take a look at one more thing before we step into our preview. Let's take a look at other games across Week 9 that are out there. Shrewsbury drew Grafton. Leominster may see Grafton coming up in the next couple of weeks. Algonquin will travel to North Middlesex. The interesting one on this list to me is Malden at Marlboro. This is a case of somebody finally paying attention and getting creative. Marlboro did not get an opponent from Central Mass's committee, so they got together with Malden, who is another 0-8 team out east, and said, hey, let's play football, and all of a sudden some creativity. Central meets East. And you see a couple of other games in Division 8 as well, with St. Bernard's and Monty Tech there as well coming along. As we turn our attention, Coach, to Week 9 action, it's Leominster and Westboro, and here comes a battle between two teams that so desperately want to turn their seasons around. Obviously, you guys, are picking up that win in, you know, the eighth week to launch yourselves into week nine. Westboro's coming off a couple of heartbreaking losses to really solid football teams, including this overtime loss to Fitchburg. That has got to be putting them in a very difficult spot coming into this week where they feel backed into a corner. They want this game more than anything else right now to salvage their season from here to week 10 and on to their Thanksgiving matchup as well.
Of course. I mean, they got a great football team. They've they play with a lot of pride. They have a lot of pride in what they do. And, they played a lot of close games this year against some tough opponents. I feel like we kind of mirror each other a little bit in terms of the schedule that we've had and some of the close games that they've had. They're going to come here and, like you said, be backed into a corner and really want to come away with a win, especially after we beat them last year, I think, on late game points that we scored and kind of took the game away from them there. So they're going to have revenge on their mind. They're going to want to come here and show what the progress that they've made and how tough they are. We have to be up to the task. We got to be ready to go.
Very fortunate to have a stable of analysts here where Mike Pellin, I was able to talk to him. He was over at that Fitchburg-Westboro game last week, said it was probably the best football game that he's seen in multiple decades. Yeah. But what he was really impressed by was, and I'm sure this is something you saw on video, the sheer number of things Coach David Tingeloff and his squad can do offensively. They just throw the kitchen sink at you. They do the same thing defensively. Here, if you can figure this out, then you can beat it.
Yeah, no, they do a good job of being able to build off of their base, their base plays and added some wrinkles and to really keep defenses on their toes. They know how to adjust to defensive adjustments, so we're going to have to be sound on what we do and play disciplined defense. As soon as we start chasing guys or really start looking in the backfield, we're gonna have problems. So we got to play our responsibilities, be disciplined and just take what comes to us. We can't go chasing guys.
This is a game that last year came down to a bounce pass for a touchdown and then a follow-up defensive play to close things out for Leominster and knocking it away in the waning seconds.
Yeah.
This was an incredibly exciting football game. Two teams, same situations, going to be looking to lock horns once again.
Sure, and I expect something special from them. I think they're going to try to come out and throw a wrinkle at us and like I said, they kind of throw the kitchen sink at you, and I wouldn't be surprised if they come out and try to do something, kind of give us a gimmick or something special to try to get us off our heels, especially early to try to take the air out of Doyle and try to do something like that. So we be prepared for that situation, and I think our line, when you look at the stats up front of their line versus our line, I think we're bigger than they are, but they have a lot of heart. They play with a lot of pride. They play with some speed. So we really we have to, like I said, have to play discipline. If we start, taking the wrong steps or, looking where we're not supposed to, then it's going to be a problem. So playing our brand, building on what we've done the last couple weeks, starting fast, I think is going to go a long way for us.
Is it fair to say that getting a contribution from your special teams or your defense is going to continue to be crucial to create those opportunities from your offense?
Absolutely, absolutely. I think it's key for us to if we can get good special teams to play that could flip the field position for us and have defense be able to hold them or come up with some takeaways there. We're gonna have to capitalize offensively. We haven't been great at that all season long. So the more chances we get there, we have to capitalize them offensively just because we've had trouble putting the ball in the end zone. Obviously we're in good position if we're getting contributions there, and we'll look to build on what we've done offensively so far and just try to string something together.
Leominster and Westboro, week 9, two teams going to look to battle one another out. It was a great game last year, going to be another exciting matchup in week 9 here in 2019. We've got split squad coverage for you as somehow on the radio side of things. We're going to cover two games at once. Why not? Let's try something new. So here's how the teams will break down. Kate will make her play-by-play full-time debut, working with Bill Thomas on Leominster and Westboro. That game will be streamed at WPKZstream.com for the live radio stream, and then with our partners here at Leominster TV on Verizon, Comcast, and Facebook Live beginning at 7 o'clock. Meanwhile, across the Twin Cities, countdown to kickoff on the K-Zone will be at 6:30 on AM 1280 and 105.3 FM. We'll have Fitchburg and North Middlesex. Myself and Mike Pellin will be over there to cover that game for you with Twin Cities coverage. I mean, we talk about the road to the rivalry. Hey, why not two rivalry games going on at the exact same time? So we'll have it all for you coming up on the K-Zone and Leominster TV as well. Facebook with all the information to keep you straight on where it is we're going. And here's the one thing we can tell you, no matter what happens, we will be back here next Monday night with a new opponent up for Leominster and, of course, Coach Devin Gates here on the Coach's Corner as well for Week 10 action on your Veterans Day Monday. So that's coming up next week. Also, of course, we always like to mention our Salute to Service broadcast that comes up this Friday night as well. So both broadcasts wear a little bit of patriotic colors in support. Thank a veteran as we go into this Veterans Day weekend as well. For Kate Robbins and Leominster head coach Devin Gates, I am Todd Robbins. Until next Monday night, so long, everybody, from the Coach's Corner.